Talk to this, can people hear me?
Yes.
I use my fingers and making those. I'm from the future.
Yeah.
I have been from the future for many, many years. I'm an Apple alum. I heard there's some Apple guys in the room. All right, Apple folks, I was there for 10 years. And I have to tell you that, I'm here now, that this is called Google Glass, and I'll talk about it for a second. But I have to say that since around 1986, when we started doing augmented reality research at Apple, I've been undergoing a thought game. I do a mind exercise all the time. I walk around and I imagine I can see the invisible information in the world. So I imagine I can look at a wall and I can see the conduits behind the wall. I look at a funny ornament on a building, I can see the historical reason for that ornament. I look at a tree and I can see the species of the tree. It's just a thought exercise, but you can do it. And it's a very evocative kind of capability that you can develop that will help you understand what the future is going to be like around the middle of the 2020s. Around 2025, maybe before or after, people will have contact lenses. They'll be wirelessly connected to some kind of device. I hope it's not an Android device, but it might be. that will then display stuff draped across the real world, geolocated. And so it's going to take very, very high resolution precision positioning to overlay the computer graphics exactly correlated with the object or place that you're looking at. So that's real-time computation between the display and the real world. That's way beyond anything we can do with GPS or any other positioning technology today. So naturally, Google Glass, which I'm wearing today, can't do that stuff. But that's okay, because Google Glass is, in fact, a very, very interesting laboratory prototype. And I think we should all be grateful to Google for making a really awesome lab prototype widely available for people like us to experiment with. But I think we have to understand that it's not like a product that's going to be introduced next season, like Oculus Rift. This is, in fact, a lab prototype, and they're putting thousands of them out in the field for people to experiment with and to give feedback to Google. So if you approach it with that attitude and don't have too high-level expectations, you're going to have a lot of fun with it. So a couple of things about Google Glass. First off, you notice that I'm looking below Google Glass. It's not augmented reality. It's not putting a veil of computer graphics over the real world. It's in fact a display up about in the upper right-hand corner of my view, same place where your rearview mirror is when you're driving a car. And I have to say, when you first start wearing Google Glass, it's a little bit of an eye strain. And so they warn you the first day, don't do it more than an hour at a time. So it puts up a little rectangle about the equivalent of an HDTV, just right up here, and it's mainly pretty much clear sans serif fonts and pictures, nothing too high resolution, nothing 3D, no stereo. So if we understand that this particular prototype is just the first step in a continuum of a whole bunch of products that are going to be coming over the next decade, then we've got the right attitude. So you saw earlier Oculus Rift, which is this full immersive headset you wear, and the nausea is not caused by suspending belief or disbelief. It's an actual physiological issue where your balance is calculated by your inner ear. And when you see something different than your inner ear is computing, it generates nausea. And so that's why these fully immersive headsets will do that to you. So I think we can imagine that there's going to be headsets that do have full binocular view, but they have dynamic transparency. So if you're sitting down comfortably in the living room, you can have a really cool 3D experience, watch stuff coming at you in much more realistic, stereographic way than ordinary 3D movies in the movie theater interact. You know, when you look at a movie like Avatar, no matter where you sit, the spear is always going to come at you. And so you're not really getting viewpoint independent 3D, but with a full stereo headset, you can look at something here, and you can walk around and you can look at a different perspective. That's because the devices themselves
have got three-dimensional position sensing, latitude, longitude, and elevation. But they've got it in very, very tiny degrees of increments, so the graphics appear in exactly the right space. Now, Google Glass itself. A couple of things to say about Google Glass first. It's not one gadget. It's actually two gadgets. To use it out in the world, you have to have your Android telephone. It'll work on an iPhone, but the My Glass app that runs with Google Glass doesn't really work on iPhone. So it's Google's lock-in strategy. As I say, it puts a view up here. Now, for us as researchers to kind of understand Google Glass, we have to understand that Google Glass is really three things. First off, it's a display that's with you wherever you go, up in the upper right rearview mirror corner. It's very intimate speech recognition, because I can speak in a very low voice and get Glass to do things for me. That's the second thing, speech recognition. The third thing is it's a point of view camera for taking snapshots and taking videos. So that is where the problem comes in. So for some bizarre reason, when Google Glass was introduced, a new meme appeared on the internet. The meme is glasshole, which is very negative. It's a real pejorative that inhibits people. So a lot of people you talk to who've got Google Glass are very, very shy about wearing it in public, because who wants to be scorned? So it's a very unfortunate way that kind of social phenomena has kept people from really experimenting. Because it's not, nobody's out there trying to prove something by wearing Google Glass. People want to just experiment and sense new things. And so, but you know, meanwhile they're doing, you know, 60-minute shows on GoPro, and GoPro's on the cover of magazines. GoPro is a wearable camera, just like Google Glass, and yet there's no scorn or pejoratives applied to GoPro wearers. So, I'll have this around so you can all try it out. There was no point in really trying to do a display here, because the only thing I could do from here that you could appreciate is like, I can stream live video of all you sitting here up on the screen. You get pretty bored looking at yourselves. So that's the end of my 7-minute talk, and do I have time for one or two questions?
Absolutely.